Now let's introduce some damping into this system. We'll keep the mass as 10 kg and the spring constant 100 newton per meter and increase the damping coefficient. We'll start with 5 newton second per meter. Let's run it. You can see the mass is still oscillating, but its amplitude start decreasing over time. The motion is a combination of oscillation and exponential decay. In this case, we call it underdamped. Now let's increase the damping coefficient to 100 newton second per meter. Now the mass is not oscillating at all. Its amplitude just exponentially decays. This case we call it overdamped. When the amplitude does not change anymore, we see the system reaches a steady state. So you see, the damping coefficient changes the system performance a lot. In fact, it is the damping ratio that defines the system performance. Recall in class, we defined the damping ratio zeta equals to b over 2 square root of k times m. So the system performance is determined by the combination of all three input parameters, the mass, the spring constant, and the damping coefficient. And we defined when zeta is smaller than 1, the system is underdamped. When zeta is greater than 1, the system is overdamped. And when it is equal to 1, the system is critically damped. This definition comes from the differential equation that describes the system motion, that is mx double dot plus bx dot plus kx equal to 0. If you solve the characteristic equation of it, there will be two roots, and the solution of x can be expressed in terms of them. The damping ratio will determine whether the roots are two complex number when zeta is smaller than 1, or two distinct real number when zeta bigger than 1, or they both equal to one real number when zeta equals to 1. And that's why you can tell the system behavior by calculating the damping ratio. We will not go through too much detail about the math here. Now let's go back to our simulation and test if the theory works for the system we built. Let's first find out when the critical damping happens. That's when damping ratio equals to 1. Then the damping coefficient should be equal to 2 times square root of k times m. Since the mass is 10 kg and the spring constant is 100 newton per meter, it gives you a damping coefficient about 63 newton second per meter. So let's change the damping coefficient to 63. So you can see it is a exponential decay. Now let's increase the damping coefficient to 95, which gives you a damping coefficient about 1.5. So again, this gives you an exponential decay as expected. But if you compare this graph with the one at critical damping, you will find that the critical damping actually takes shorter time to reach to the steady state. It takes about 2 seconds to get to the flat area, while this one, overdamped case, takes about 4 seconds. Now let's reduce the damping coefficient to 30. Which gives you a damping ratio about 0.47. You can see now the amplitude decays, but there is a dip before it reaches to the steady state. This is a sign of the oscillation. Compare with the one we just had when damping coefficient was only 5, this one has less oscillation, but reaches to the steady state sooner, about 4 seconds. But if compared with the critical damping case, this underdamped case still takes longer for it to reach steady state. So you can see the critical damping has the fastest decay rate. Another thing to notice is that the first decays when our damping coefficient is only 5. So let's change it back to 5. So under this case, it looks like the system is still oscillating with the same period as when there was no damping at all. Their periods are both about 2 seconds. You can actually calculate the damped frequency for underdamped case using this equation. Since the damping ratio is small, only 0.08 in this case, the damped frequency does not change much. It is still 0.993 of its original. And therefore, when damping ratio is relatively small, the period of oscillation can be considered almost the same as the free oscillation case. In this video, we only changed one input parameter. You can do your own simulation, play with all three parameters, and see if you can get the same results as your theoretical calculation.